shit is powwow.
The Powwow with Mo podcast.
What up? Welcome to the Powwow with Mo podcast. I'm Mo.
I am Powwow.
And this is episode 18, and it will be coming out on my birthday.
Yes, it will.
So, we'll just get into current events. I feel like the last half of this one will be a little long, so
we're going
to try to make
sure.
The first half a little quicker. First thing I saw that I had to bring up to you is the other day randomly, and I know I saw a commercial today, so if I waited just a few days, I could have known this.
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, I haven't heard anything about Celebrity Big Brother.
Yep.
Like, just at all. They ended, like, when August or whatever, and they're like, it's coming, and then you heard nothing.
And then you just seen the, like, well, this week.
I actually didn't see it. I went out of my way to look it up.
Okay.
And then, like, the next day, I saw a commercial.
Yep.
And I was like, oh, okay. The thing I'm disappointed about is it starts February 7th and ends February 24th.
Yeah.
And there's only 10 house guests. They're going to do still live evictions, but I'm guessing they're going to do it like every 3 days someone gets evicted.
And the setup that they have, I'm slightly disappointed because I did see the pictures that they had of the house.
Yeah.
But again, they have not come out once and said one person that's on the show, which to me means that they're going to have random uncles of people who played on some, you know, 16 and pregnant show.
Right.
I just feel like it's going to be a terrible Celebrity Big Brother. Even if it was just, hey, we're going to have a quick Big Brother of normal people, that's fine. Don't call it celebrity if these people aren't actual celebrity.
Right. I would have preferred just a normal Big Brother in the winter. Just the last time they did it, I guess people went crazy and there was way too much sex and debauchery and
yeah,
it got too crazy or something. But apparently they're only doing it to go against the Olympics because that's the exact same time the Olympics runs. Just CBS's way of combating it. And I'll try to watch both. I mean, I'm going to watch it.
I am ready, and I know you are too, for some curling.
I love watching curling.
I don't know what it is. It is those little...
It's because I feel like if I lived in a cold place, I could have grown up mastering that.
Mastering some curling?
Because I love shuffleboard, and it's just shuffleboard. And another reason I like it is there was this Digimon game on PlayStation 1 in which it had a curling mini game that was the best part of that game.
Mm-hmm.
So for whatever reason, that's always stuck with me, and I love curling.
Yeah, I mean, curling's awesome. All right. So one thing that I've seen this week is that there's a new shoe coming out for Paul George, and it's PlayStation themed.
I saw that.
So
it looks awesome.
The PlayStation logo will be on the tongue of the shoe.
I think just one side, and then the other side has the Nike. Something like that.
Now, the logo is going to glow in blue, and when you press it, it's going to vibrate like a controller. Because, you know, you want your shoes
popular
to vibrate.
With the ladies.
Talk about foot fetish. The shoe has a 150-hour battery that's non-replaceable, so once it goes out, it's out.
Right.
But the soles of the shoe is going to be painted in a galaxy theme, mimicking that home screen of the PlayStation.
Right.
And whenever you buy it, you will get a network code that when scanned, it'll unlock a special Paul George theme for the gaming console.
That is cool.
And it's $110 for the shoe, which for a brand new Nike shoe and getting some of these extras isn't really that bad. Seeing how some of those brand new Nikes are like $150.
Right.
Which is crazy to me because back then it was like spend no more than $75 on a shoe.
Yeah, well.
Or $100 if you're hitting the shops.
And to me, and I've learned the hard way growing up, that like, I can only wear Nike flat foot, like the kind of have the flat soles, because I have a wide foot, and any of their basketball shoes are just, they're going to suffocate my foot.
Yeah, for sure.
Because they don't make wide Nikes. Just not a thing they do.
That's true.
So every week it seems like we have a story of someone with the whole sexual allegation thing, right? And so this one's like, I don't want to say a good story, but it's not as bad as the others.
Mm-hmm.
So Aziz Ansari got...
Yep.
Accused, I guess is the right word.
Yeah, that's
and then
what I'd go with.
The story kind of came out, and more or less, they went on a date. They had consensual sex.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, he got weird or she felt uncomfortable with it, but she never said no or stopped. And then now is like, me too.
Right? Yeah, exactly.
Me too movement. And then this lady on CNN went off, and she was like, you're an embarrassment to all the other women who are really in the movement.
Yeah.
And, I mean, it sucks for Aziz because it's like... He was
your name's slightly tarnished.
Right, but not really. But
it's
it
was still thrown out there.
Right.
And you're going to have some of those crazy people go, no, this was real. She was molested or something crazy. And that's just what happens.
Right, but I was at least glad to see that an accusation got out there that was checked. in some way, right? People like looked into it and were like, well, actually, that's not the same as these others, right?
Exactly.
So that was good.
Yeah. So with your team today, because I've got a segue into this, and with your team playing the Patriots today, unfortunately, the Jacksonville Jaguars lost today 24-20.
Right. And I'll kind of take some of the blame, and I'm going to explain why, because I haven't told you this.
Okay.
I fell asleep this afternoon, right?
Uh-huh.
And when I woke up, they were up 14-3.
So you shouldn't have been watching the game is what you're
and
saying.
And I walk in, and as soon as I walk in the room, they get three penalties in a row, and the Patriots
what?
Were a touchdown.
That's when you should have said, you know what? I got to take one for the team and not watch this game.
Well, at halftime, I told Koopy that. I was like, I really feel like I'm doing this. And I always have those moments. Like, as soon as I turn on, like, a Thunder game, and it's like an 8-0
exactly.
run, I'm like, it's me. But I'm like a super rational person. So I was like, well, that's stupid.
Yeah.
There's a 3-second delay, right? I mean, come on, it's not even love. And I just continued watching and then they lost. So it might have been my fault, but watching the game, I didn't feel like Jacksonville was bad. I just felt like Tom Brady kept getting crazy. Tom Brady.
Yeah. I mean,
throws
just...
and every single call penalty wise on the field went against Jacksonville. Now they might have been legitimate, but it was just one of those games where it's like no penalties on the Patriots.
I seen
all
the meme
on the Jaguars
after the first quarter where it shows Bill Belichick talking to the ref saying, we're losing to the fucking Jaguars. Fix this shit.
Right.
Like that was just funny. But with that being said, there was a story where light poles in Philadelphia are being greased by the local officials. The
so
reason why is they're in preparation if the Philadelphia Eagles make the Super Bowl so they cannot climb up them. However, some people still believe that these liquored up people are going to be able to climb up these super poles.
You know, like those like prep schools where it's like they oil people up and have to climb up a statue or something.
Something
like,
crazy, yeah.
See some videos on Facebook or whatever. Which gets me a segue to my next little point I have in here is I'm back off Facebook.
Yep.
It was fun. Now, I will say, me being on Facebook and posting about the podcast, we got lots of views. Not sure if it was directed to that, but we've gotten like a few hundred from San Francisco.
Yeah.
Which
so,
we don't
yeah.
know
by the
who
way,
that is.
Whoever is listening in from San Francisco, please email us at thepowwowwithmo@gmail.com.
Yeah, she'll know who it is.
Exactly.
We might know. I don't know. And then we also have quite a few out of Tokyo in the last week. So, now Clayton Holderby, Navy, maybe he's in Tokyo. I don't know. That's my only guess.
I don't know. I mean, he's always posting pics, so he could be.
So I got back, as soon as I got off Facebook, though, all of our listens started going down. So I'm like, shit, maybe I should just be on there posting every week about it. So I might come back. But in general, Facebook was not enjoyable. It was, I don't care about people's kids in general. I like your kids. I go to your house and see your kids.
Exactly.
I don't need to go on the internet. And then people just complaining.
And this crazy.
Or they want to share their Bible verses. I don't know. Just I was just like, none of this is enjoyable. I like following Sideshow. He posts funny memes, and he's
always
like,
posting some.
He
good
is
memes.
The only highlight for my Facebook feed. Now you can deactivate, and you're still on Messenger, so I can still hit people up. Like this week, we're gonna mention a couple people I rapped with, so I'm gonna be like, hey, listen to the podcast. But I am back off Facebook and feeling all right about it.
Yeah, for sure. So. Speaking of Facebook and all the crazy memes, with the government shutdown that's on day two now, I do find it funny because I have a lot of Republican family members and friends on there where they say, you know, that especially the military ones that has a picture of military people saying we're not going to get paid because the Democrats want to pay these illegals that are, you know, flipping off the camera or whatever. Because, of course, the Democrats hold the majority in both the Senate.
Right.
Let's make sure we're clear, right?
Again, like, this is me trying to not be, like, side Republicans or Democrats. But what I've noticed since I've been an adult is as soon as whoever's in power, everyone's views flip. So when Obama was in power, government shut down, it was all his fault. And Trump is on record on his tweets and different things saying that, well, if the government shuts down, president should be fired. It starts at the top. All of this shit, right, that he, of course, would not stand behind now. And in Republicans, when they were the opposition party,
I mean,
you know, they just had a bitch about stuff. Yeah, they could throw out like, "Oh, we're letting it shut down because that's what's good." And then now,
exactly,
it's the other way. Everyone's
like,
rhetoric
like I understand
changes.
The reason why they shut it down is because they don't want that guy. I get it, but at the end of the day, you can't say that you voted no for something, and they're like, "Well, it's their fault because they also voted no."
And something that's come up, and I'm sure you've seen as well, is I guess in Australia when this happens, they just fire the prime minister. It's just in their Australian constitution or whatever. And I guess the last time it happened, they just restart. They redid everything. They were like, well, obviously this didn't work. And they restructured their whole government, relaunched it, and it hasn't shut down since. So maybe we really do need a major shakeup. I personally think it's all the billions and billions of dollars we spend on the military. And
yeah,
I know like we want universal health care, but honestly, there is a problem with universal health care in America because with Medicare and other health care policies, whenever a company is footing the bill, then hospitals are going to be like, well, then we're going to jack the prices. Mm-hmm. And then insurance companies could be like, well, we're not paying that full thing. Let's work out deals. There's a lot of shady shit going on.
Yeah, because they want to get their money too.
If everyone did just pay for their health stuff, I do think prices would go down. You would at least be... it'd be more upfront in some sort of way. Like, what am I paying for?
Yeah.
Give me an itemized statement of what, not like this whole, this huge bill and it's like, don't worry, insurance takes
care of
it. Yeah, like,
exactly.
That has to cause some bloating, you know, in the system.
Agreed. And I mean, again, very prominent Republican, Lindsey Graham, he voted no. Dude, so he voted towards a government shutdown. Now, granted, again, it's because of the DACA initiative, and he said that, well, it's, I don't see what the big deal is. They're not going to get shut down till March, so that's not a true emergency, because God forbid we take care of something before the very last day that it comes up.
Well,
I think Paul Ryan
has the best quote about his party. I think I told this to you the other day, and his quote was, we were the opposition party for 10 years, and that was easy. And now we have to govern, and that's hard.
Oh, I don't.
No, but like, I think in the basic sense of it, that is true. Like,
yes,
Republicans have not had to really pass laws in so long because their goal was, and they were upfront about it during the Obama administration, was we are going to do so little, he will look bad. That was their plan.
I mean, Turtle came out and said, hey, we're going to veto every bill that Obama puts up. That was their goal for 6 straight years.
Right. So whenever you have people that like their whole time in Congress was that, they probably legitimately don't know how to get stuff passed. Mm-hmm. Like they just don't have the experience. So we'll see what happens. I'll say the government shutdown doesn't affect me. I still see cops and fire trucks and everybody else here.
Yep,
now,
I still see them all.
I don't know how long this would have to go until we would legitimately see it affect our society. I've always been curious, even during all the Obama years. I was like, how long until we like see some stuff fall apart?
Yeah,
I just don't know what happens there.
Agreed. So the last thing that I want to bring up is regarding the box office. Surprisingly, Jumanji has held it for the third straight week.
I mean, it's The Rock and it's Kevin Hart.
Agreed. And I mean, you throw in Jack Black, you still get some of those.
I love Jack Black.
Agreed. They just want to watch it because those people are in
it. Spoiler alert, when we do our top five favorite bands, it's up there.
Exactly.
Love Jack Black.
But they, in the 5 weeks that they've been open, they have $317 million just domestic.
Yeah.
I mean, I really thought it was, I haven't seen it. I just assumed it would have that 1 or 2 week flutter and then they were going to fall off.
Right.
So I am really surprised that they have been able to hold it for so long.
I mean, it's become a fairly well-known fact with Tyler Perry's success that, like, the black population will support a movie with black actors in it. Like, that's just, like, they go to the movies at, like, a higher percentage for what they're, like, I don't know. They just go, they'll support those things. So, it's not surprising, but it is surprising because it was named Jumanji and it's about a video game and they're fucking pissing all over Robin Williams' grave with the name of this movie. But,
yeah.
I understand how it's making so much money also.
Agreed.
All right, I had a couple things. Not necessarily all current events. Let's see. Oh, I had a fun conspiracy theory I saw this week that I wanted to bring up because it was something we talked about last week.
Mm-hmm.
There was the missile threat, right, in Hawaii.
Yes.
This conspiracy theory is missile was launched. Text goes out of, hey, missile's incoming. Our defense system blows the missile up. And then they send out, go, never mind. That was a false alert.
It's such a good conspiracy theory that it's hard to argue.
I know. It's so dope. I really hope that's what happened.
Agreed.
But the only thing against it is I don't think Trump could have let
that
happen.
That's what I was going to say. He's like, we fucking blew up your shit.
Right.
10 miles outside of a getting shot.
I think he would have bragged about it.
He would have been like, that small button that you have in that terrible rocket couldn't even, you know what I mean? I just think he would go off about it.
Right. All right, I have three small things. Apple's coming back to America, opening up a headquarters. They're going to bring, like, I think it was like $38 billion worth of taxes they'll have
to pay just
to open this place. And they said they're doing it to help out the country.
That's pretty sweet.
Now, honestly, my thought, and I'm as you can tell from this, I'm not the biggest Trump fan. Do these people really love him? Like, why would these companies wait until he's president to do this instead of when Obama was, unless he legitimately is doing something that's helping businesses? Well, the new tax plan
that did come out does help businesses.
So,
now, granted, much smaller LLCs are going to get much more benefit, but if you're a business, I guarantee you, he goes, you know what, you come back, I guarantee you I'll drop your tax down to below 30% by 20 whatever.
I know, I'm just surprised.
No, agree.
Because those were the people that were like, oh, we got to be above this.
Well, agree. I mean, I am.
I think they just talk a certain way in public and they feel another way in private.
Agree. I mean, I am by far not a Trump fan, but if he is able to bring in that amount of revenue that we desperately need to help with this deficit.
I mean, I'm an evidence person. If you show me evidence, I'm all
then
for it.
I'll go for it. I'm not going to hate on it for it. Now, granted, I don't think you should get reelected in 2020, but I don't think Oprah should either. That's a whole other rabbit hole. But I agree. I mean, that's pretty awesome. I did see where there is a short list of 20 cities for Amazon to build their next headquarters, and it's a $10 billion bid. Like, that's I want to know what these 20 cities are because they didn't say in the article. But that's the short list that they have of over the 300 people or 300 cities that applied. But that's a lot of money, a lot of revenue being brought in.
Right. I just see us living in a world in the future that's like one of those dystopian futures where, like, everyone works for these three corporations. Mm-hmm. And if you get fired from one of those, you're just a homeless person.
Yep.
And
you're done.
Oh, man. All right. Other things I have here. I've been watching The Office. Like, I've been telling you, I've been rewatching all that. I do think Office Season 6 is the best season.
Okay.
Now, I used to always say first three seasons, like Seasons 2 and 3, I always...
Is Season 6 where they get the new HR lady?
I think the very beginning. Okay. It's a long season. That helps. Mm-hmm. And a lot happens. So, I mean, that's where they get sold to Saber.
Yeah.
Kathy Bates comes
Sabre.
In. And then you get... Yeah. And then Gabe. Gabe is great.
Oh, Gabe. It is weird, funky.
But
cell.
There's like a four-episode run that's so good. There's been a murder... Oh, I love that episode.
And Creed takes off running. Right. And I love
that
there.
And then that one's in this four episode run that was like four of my favorite. I was like, oh shit. I was like, man, maybe season six is my favorite.
Yeah.
So anyway, I had to share with you because me and you
love it.
Love The Office. All right. Something else that pissed me off yesterday. So I got your son a hat for his birthday because I always wear a hat and he wanted a hat, one that fit him because mine are too big. So I go to Hibbett's, look for a hat. In Hibbett's is a sports store, if anyone's unfamiliar. Mm-hmm. They have this whole wall of Thunder shirts and jerseys, right?
Yeah.
Which is amazing. And then the only other NBA shirt or jersey that they have in there are Golden State, Kevin Durant, and Steph Curry jerseys.
Are you serious?
And then all the rest are... And it just, to me, I was like, fuck this place.
Exactly. I'm not even going to buy it from here.
Still fucking Rocket shit, LeBron shit.
Even the Mavericks, somewhere that's around here, if anything.
Yeah, but no. Kevin Durant, Steph Curry, and then all Thunder.
I mean, I just know us crazy Oklahoma people, I'm surprised someone hasn't went in there and just burnt down some of those jerseys purely because it says Kevin Durant on it.
And I've seen kids still rock Durant stuff.
Not saying
they were telling
anyone to do that, by the way.
You know, and I get it. He, you grow up watching him and whatever, and you love him. But I was like, come on, that's a bullshit.
Exactly.
Then go online and get that shit.
Exactly. I don't need to go here.
Yeah. All right. And then my last thing, I beat Nier Automata, my third playthrough. So I finally beat it. I could go back and get some trophies, but I was like, you know what? I feel good with what I did. Put a lot of hours into this game and went ahead and deleted it off the PlayStation. But I know I've told you about the show Masters of Sex, right? Mm-hmm. And it's about like this historical thing where they studied sex, basically, Masters and Johnson, and put out these books about it. And one of the things they talk about is after you ejaculate, you have a refractory period, which is like that moment where you're like, I don't want to have sex for this like 5 minute period
or
whatever
it is. Yeah, don't touch me. Yeah, right. I got it.
And I feel like that exists with video games because I have all these games to play. But like as soon as I beat it, I just set down my controller and I went to start something. And I was like, nope,
can't do it.
Can't do it yet. Like I waited a couple days and now I've been playing a little NBA 2K.
So it's your after sex for video games.
Right. So okay. It's like beating a game's kind of like coming basically.
Yep.
And you got to wait a second. So I've started off slow, a little basketball, played a couple games of that, getting back into just hitting some buttons.
Got to warm up.
Everybody's golf. And I'll get back to Persona 5. But Nier Automata was such a weird Japanese game, and so is Persona.
Had to get weird
with
like, it.
I need a little American basketball in my life.
Get back to your roots.
And this is a weird segue because I've never done, but I'm going to do it because I brought up basketball, and I'm just going to go straight into Travis's email. So let me pull that up.
Okay.
So Travis, who was a fraternity brother of ours.
Shout out, friend, Travis. And
I will say, because I was talking to Koopy about Travis this week, because, you know, she was like, Travis, you said some random last name, and I was like, no, that's on his last name, and I said his last name, right? And I was like, man, honestly, when we were pledging, Travis was at the apartment all the time. Like, I don't think about it, because there towards the end of him graduating college, he had to, like, quit hanging out with us as much, and I get it. When I had to graduate, I had to quit it as well. But Travis is always around kicking it. But he wrote in about our top five sports video games.
Yes.
And he agreed that NBA 2K is number one on his list too. He said he knows I like the single player side of games.
Yep.
But he really enjoys the pro-am mode. I agree. The pro-am mode in theory is amazing. So I'm just going to explain my like dark secret of NBA 2K is like, if I'm playing single player, even on a Hall of Fame difficulty, cause I'll jack up the difficulty on the game, I could still score like 50 points a game, and I'm really good on the offline modes. As soon as I go online to my park or pro-am, I cannot make a shot. I don't know if my internet's not good enough, and so like if there's like just enough lag that I can never get a perfect release on a three-point jump shot.
Yeah.
But I'm just not good online. And I also make little short point guards who are good at three-point shooting, and online everyone else is like, I'm a 7-foot small forward, so I'm just not good online. So in theory, yes, I do like the pro-am. I have played where I've had 40 point games on there, but there's also times where I have like 2 points and I'm shitty, so I don't love the online just because I'm not good at it now. I have started a power forward that's like a Blake Griffin build, so I'm not worried about shooting.
I'll say terrible at shooting.
And I got him up to about an 81 so far, and I'm just slowly working on him on the side so just that I can go online with that one. So maybe someday I will enjoy it. But Travis did say he is the type of guy who just buys like $50 worth of the virtual currency day one. And I think if you're going to do it, that's probably the best way to do it. Just do
day
it all.
Day one, get it.
And then so you can build on that. So, I mean, I don't think that's horrible. Just me personally, I just played the My GMO to build up coins that way.
For sure.
And then he has a top five of my songs. So the top five for this week will be my songs that I've recorded in the past for my birthday. Some of these I don't know. So top eight, I do not know what that is. He said it was on my MySpace. I looked for it. That doesn't exist anymore, the MySpace page. So couldn't find that. Pi KA, which we will talk about later in our timeline.
Yeah, also we're going to have to.
Was a kind of a big deal. Dog Eat Dog.
I have no idea.
No idea. I'm guessing it's a freestyle. Probably a shitty one at that, but it's on here. Two different people, which we'll see later. And then 18, 19, 20, which almost made my list, but didn't. And then he also likes a song called Get High, Play Video Games.
Yeah.
That song is cool. I really like it because I have three different style verses. Like,
yeah,
not
I'll say
one's,
it's different. Yeah.
Sounds like three different people did it or whatever. And there's probably a tons more. So, yeah, Travis has always liked my song, so that makes him cool.
Yeah,
in my book.
For sure.
And Powwow, where can people email us at?
They can email us at thepowwowwithmo@gmail.com. That is thepowwowwithmo@gmail.com. And if anyone is down in the Purcell area looking to eat some healthy food, stop by Travis's store. We'll pull it up here in a little bit and talk some more about it. But appreciate Travis writing in.
All right. And then the only little thing I left is I mentioned a couple weeks ago the TV show Crashing with Pete Holmes. It's an HBO show. It came back on last Sunday. So tonight will be the second episode of the season. It's even better, the second season. I mean, I know it's only one episode, but it seems better already.
Yeah.
So I'm real excited for that show, and I think everyone should check it out.
For sure.
All right, let's take a quick break, and then when we get back, we're going to do a timeline of my rap career that isn't really a rap career. It's like a failed rap career, I guess. And then
I would say failed because you never really tried to pursue a...
True.
A long-standing, but...
True, true. And then we'll do our top five songs, and then if you have any questions, wherever, you'll have to ask questions and shit.
All right, sounds good.
All right. All right, and we're back.
All right.
All right, so we're going to get into rap timeline.
Yes.
If you have any questions or input here and there, and I'm sure I will as well, we'll just put it in, see if we can get through the whole thing.
Yep.
All right, so the first time I kind of rapped was in 2006, but that wasn't in front of any people. That was like, I got kicked out of the dorms. I got my own little apartment, and then I tried to rap on like a little sound recorder on Windows with like a shitty mic that cost $5 at Walmart. So none of that exists.
Yep.
Half of the stuff didn't even rhyme. But, you know, it was good practice at the time to be locked in my room practicing that.
Gotcha.
So 2007, and really the first time I think of me as like I rapped or whatever, is I moved into a new apartment. Anthony Logan, good friend of ours, he was my neighbor. And he convinced me to go out to this bar called Legends that we loved in college.
Yep.
It was the first time I'd went there, and there were some guys, Travis was one of them, who were in my calculus class, who were there, and all this Greek lettered stuff, because my first year of college, I didn't even know Greek systems were a thing until the spring, and they basically were like, you want a beer? We have beer, and they were basically rushing me, and I didn't realize it at the time. So they just
sneaky.
Right, and so they just kept trying to get me convinced to pledge. Now, at the time, I also had like a crazy mohawk, like, it was like a foot tall, and I forget all about that until I see pictures. I'm like, oh yeah, I totally did that at 18.
I know what you mean. Or
I guess I was 19 at this time.
Yep.
And so I basically said, well, if y'all have anyone in your fraternity that can rap better than I can, I will pledge your fraternity. And they're like, oh, we got people that can rap.
Oh my God. And here the comes first people, Chucka Jones.
Well, actually, the first person was Johnny A.
Okay.
Who was my big for a minute.
Yep.
He was like their only black. Well, I guess there's Darkness too. But Johnny A was the only black guy that would rap. They had. And he said like four lines. And then he was done.
Yep. That was it.
And then Chucka Jones, who also fraternity Chuck, brother of ours.
Yeah.
He rapped. And he's like a tattooed, kind of emo looking guy. Right? I think it's somewhat accurate. At least at that time period for what he looked like. And he was like, I was just like, oh, well, you know, he did it in front of all these people. And I never rapped in front of anybody.
Yeah.
And so I was like, well, I guess I'll try it. And then I rapped for like 30 minutes. And then when I was done, there was like 80 people around us in a big circle. And then I almost had a heart attack because I'm super introverted shy person. And I was like, oh, shit, oh, shit, oh, shit. But that was awesome. And I was like, wow, that was super cool.
Yeah.
So that was like my first little taste of that. And then on the way home, Anthony Logan had this cousin who was gay and lived with these four other gay guys, and they lived at this place they called the Q5, and he made me stop there and freestyle for basically a huge party of not all gay guys, but a lot of gay guys and then some ladies or whatever, and then I rapped, and all the gay guys were like, you're fucking awesome, and I was like, thanks, and then we went home, and that was how that evening went. It was a great night. I was like, man, I'm fucking awesome. That was my thought.
Big confidence.
And then every time we went to Legends after that for a while, I mean, up until you got to college and we went, like, I was always just freestyling and stuff. So basically from spring all the way up for a while, like, freestyling was my shit. That's all. I never wrote. I was like, I'm like Lil Wayne and Jay-Z. I don't write shit. I only freestyle. I was all about it. Plenty of times of me, like, battling quote-unquote people. It's not really battling because I wasn't making fun of it. It was just like, you freestyle and I'm gonna freestyle, and then people are gonna judge who was better, right? Like, that's more or less what it was. I had a lot of friends on the football team. There'd be black dudes that knew I could rap, and they'd bring me in the circle, and I'd act like I was shitty, and then other guys would go, and then I would go, and they would get pissed at me because I acted like I was shitty and I wasn't. Now, looking back, I'm like, I probably was shitty, but just freestyling is different at a party. Like, if you say, like, a good line every few or five, like, five
people go nuts.
Lines or so. Right, people freak out.
As long
out.
As you get the crowd on your side, you're golden.
Right, and I normally get fairly animated compared to the way I am just in normal life.
Yeah, for
so
sure.
I think that added a lot to it. But, yeah, I've wrapped up parties, recorded some freestyles. The fall of 2007, we joined the fraternity.
Yep, we did.
And then, I mean, that was really when I freestyled everywhere. Another time I remember is a rush party. You were there, I think, at this one at Megan Schroeder's house.
Mm-hmm.
And Sunshine, who was a FITAL.
Yep.
But at this time, he was rushing Pike.
I think so. I don't remember.
It was weird.
He rushed all three, I believe.
But he challenged me, right, or whatever. And I freestyle in front of all these people. And that's when, like, a good majority of people in the Greek system heard me and were like, oh, shit.
Yeah.
So that was a really fun night, I remember. And then I made a song, Pi K.A., which we mentioned earlier in Travis's top five. And it was a big deal at the time. That was probably the first song that I, like, actually made a song.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, we got to have a hook, and then I'm going to do verses. And I freestyled it all. And there's inaccurate things. Like, I say our colors are maroon and yellow, and that's just not the colors.
No, garnet and old gold.
But I hadn't even signed a bid card yet.
Yeah.
And Travis was like, you got to do
it. You got to do it.
The A-Bay-Bay song. We're going to do Pi K.A. And it was really fun. We did
it. Was.
I was the only person in the fraternity that did not have it as a ringtone.
I was like, everyone besides you had it as a ringtone. And I remember that was a semester when I pledged, I got my phone cover when you could get those from like Skin It or whatever.
Right.
And I had Pike A on my phone. And then I also had that ringtone that played for everything.
Right. So, I mean, that was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun there. Something I didn't put on my timeline, but it just came to me and is a great story. We're going to have to really get into like fraternity stories one time and we'll retell this one. But a quick one here is a lot of stuff happened. We end up in Edmond.
Oh, man.
Right. And yeah. We'll tell the full story another time. But we wound up in Edmond at the Pike House there, and we have to go do get a shirt signed by the sorority.
Yeah, I'll say that's the best way to say it.
Right. And they all have things for us to do for it. And every place we're at, LV, who I haven't heard from
always
in months, hopefully we will someday.
Yeah.
He Ryan, basically makes every sorority make me rap in order for them to sign our shirts.
Yeah, makes it more difficult for sure.
And then the guys already told me that I couldn't cuss.
Yeah.
And if you've heard me on this podcast or the songs you'll hear later, that is very hard for me to do. I like to cuss. And so I did it or whatever. And it was fun. It made it for even more fun. Now, I remember that being a big,
it was.
Big thing too. But I just really enjoyed freestyling. That's hard for me to imagine now because I cannot freestyle anymore, but I used to be really
good
at it.
Every part of you did.
So spring, still freestyling. In the summer of 2008, me and you got our first apartment together.
We did.
Tanglehood. And
the Tanglehood.
I said I don't ever remember really recording there. And then you remember, I do remember when we first met KV, we lived there, me and him freestyled some on a computer. So I'm sure I recorded a few things here or there, but at that time you had a crazy girlfriend. I had a crazy girlfriend. Our lives were so stupid that I just don't remember ever.
I'm not
really
trying to block
anything.
A lot of it out. Agreed.
Right. I just, that is like that time in my life that like, I remember some fun stuff me and you did there, but there's a lot of it that I'm like, just can't even think about it.
Yep. Agree with you.
And then in the winter of 2008, I got a new apartment where I was living by myself. My life was still crazy, but it was like almost to the point of about to get cool again.
Mm-hmm.
And so that gets me to 2009, get crazy girlfriend out of the picture. And then I started basically to record freestyles again. And basically at that point, also at this point, Marshall's coming over a lot. I mentioned last week, I was playing lots of NCAA. This is all the same time period of me being like, oh, this is going to be real cool. That summer, I got a job with a movie theater.
I remember that. Because you used to always bring those big old giant bags of popcorn home.
Exactly. And I worked at projectors because I had the old ass film projectors. Mm-hmm. So I just had to get those started at certain times and I could just sit there and write. So that was kind of when I first started to think about writing. Mm-hmm. And the way I started writing was I just freestyled in my head and was like, that's cool. I'll write it down.
Yeah.
Freestyle my head. Right. And maybe that's how everyone does it. I don't know. But Shad moved in that summer at some point in time.
He did.
And I recorded my first mixtape, which I called Summer Job.
Yep.
I have it on my computer, but it does not exist online that I know of.
I have anywhere. The CD that's terribly scratched, but I've still got it.
Right. And almost that whole thing is freestyled. There is almost, I don't think there's any written stuff on Summer Job that I can think of. None of those are going to make my top five list. It's just too early in the process.
I understand.
Now, during this time, SoundClick.com was a very big deal for me.
Yes.
Soulja Boy just blew up and he like kind of got his start there. Mm-hmm. Right? And so when I got onto the forums, people were still talking about that. It was a cool place in the forums to just meet people. Two of the people you'll hear later on in our top five, I met through SoundClick. Mm-hmm. Almost everyone I rapped with, I met on that website. So it was just a cool place. They used to have competitions where it was like, what are the top eight songs on SoundClick right now? And you could challenge people and then people would vote. And it was just a lot of fun. I had one song on there, the Badass Rapper song, which came on next one. So in fall of 2009, so just a few months after Summer Job, I made another mixtape called Captain Mogier, which is just my last name without an R on it and a little apostrophe. And that came from, I mean, Bryce Boho, I don't think he'll ever listen to this, but if he did, he would remember it. There was a kid we went to school with named Cody Kirkland who called me Captain Mogier for whatever reason. And so when I needed a name for it, I was like, we're just going to name it that. That's probably like half freestyles, half being written on that one. So I started to get into writing a little bit there and kind of basically again, taught myself. And I have a very basic system. I got 16 lines, four, 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 group them together. I'm a little more complicated now, but in general, that's still kind of how I write things.
Yeah.
2010, Shad moved home. He was a little homesick.
He was.
Didn't deal well in Ada. And then I just started getting on a lot of collabs through SoundClick, different things. And then SDB, which was a huge deal. I really hope Demonic listens to this. I'll hit him up to see if he will.
For sure.
But SDB was strictly down to business. It was like this online radio station. I don't want to like oversell it or undersell it because I just don't know what the listener numbers were at the time. I don't remember that. But it was like every Tuesday and Thursday, we had an internet radio show. I was cool with a lot of the guys on there. And so my songs would get played, their songs would get played. A lot of us would be in the chat room, make a lot of connections.
I just remember in the chat room a lot.
Yeah, you would be in the chat room. I just don't remember like how popular it was, but it was a lot of fun. Like it made your music feel like it had a point, even if it didn't.
Exactly.
Right. So I really, I really enjoyed it. And a lot of my old songs, I mentioned SDB. Like it was a fun thing. Because like, you know, Lil Wayne's going to mention Young Money.
Yep.
I'm going to mention SDB. That was the way I thought about it.
Yeah.
Right? Like that was my group of people. Summer of 2010, I think I took the biggest leap in my rap career, maybe, until this last one, maybe. But Call It What You Want 1.
I was like, Call It What You Want, yeah.
I just, in my mind, I had this fun thing where I was going to be like, people ask me if I rap, and I tell them, call it what you want. And that was like my whole thing, right?
Yeah.
Because I even now still feel like, I mean, I kind of rap, but it doesn't sound like other rap music. Mm-hmm. It could probably be a different genre. I could probably be like, like in a gym class hero sort of thing, right?
Yeah.
And do that as opposed to real rap music. So that was my whole thing. I think there's a lot of really fun songs on there. I think I really found my groove as far as how I write. Going back, I just think all my mixing's bad. I wish I rapped with a different confidence. Like learning how to make your voice sound a certain way was a big thing to learn that I didn't know then.
I really like Call It What You Want. I mean, two of my top five songs come from that mix.
Right. So, and I mean, and there's somewhat of a nostalgia factor to that. Like, we just had so much fun in that time period.
Things got nuts.
Right. Like, that was probably, like, the most fun time of our life, maybe. Yeah. You know what I mean? And, like, this is what we were listening to.
Agreed.
So, that goes a long way. And then in the fall of 2010 was a busy year for me. I do a mixtape, which two songs, one in my top five, one in your top five are on, Blonde Hair Don't Care. Which I make with probably like my best internet friend.
Yeah.
Barkley.
Mr. Barkley.
Hopefully he'll listen in on this as well. Now, when he first hit me up, it was really cool. It was another big ego boost thing. And he could have just been bullshitting. I don't know. I never asked him. But he hits me up and it was like, I think you're so good. And I would just love it if one day I was good enough to do a song with you. And this is like, no one's ever hit me up before that of like, I think you're good at music. So I was just like, fuck it, let's do a song right now. Like, the fact you want to do music with me and you think I'm good, let's just do it.
I mean, again, another one of my top five off of Blonde Hair Don't Care.
Right, so we ended up making a whole mixtape, because I don't think Barkley ever did a solo mixtape. I think this was like going to get him warmed up to that. But that was probably the most fun I had making a mixtape, because you did collaborate and you're like, hey, I have this idea, and you know, you both mix a little bit here and there, kind of share some responsibilities.
Yeah.
But I really like Blonde Hair Don't Care, and Barkley and Jay King, who I rapped with a lot, those two people I've never met in real life, but I feel like I've met them in real life.
Yeah.
Because I've talked to them so much on the internet and we've done so many songs together. So anyway, we've done a whole track together. He's white, I'm white, we have light colored hair. Mine's not really blonde anymore, but we made a mixtape called Blonde Hair Don't Care.
Yep.
Super good. All right. And then in the winter of 2010, released Smokelahoma.
Yep.
Which is one of my favorite names that I've ever come up
with. Agree.
Now, there is like a barbecue sauce or something, barbecue places that have that name. But at the time of us coming up with it, we didn't know this existed.
Nope.
We just thought we were super clever.
Yeah, it was awesome.
And we rocked that. Now, Smokelahoma was almost all throwaway tracks from the next mixtape that came out. It was just like things I didn't think were good enough at the time. And they were a lot more weed-oriented, given the name Smokelahoma.
Yeah.
Again, in college, that was just kind of the way we rolled.
Because that was right when we moved in together, right? Again, for the second time?
Right. So we moved, because you moved away, came back, lived next to me, and then we got an apartment together again.
Yep.
Like the same week I released Smokelahoma. And then 2011, I'm basically just working on what I released in the summer of 2011, which is Call What You Want 2. And that was like my pride and joy forever.
That was like the holy grail for a while.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, until this last week when I really went back and listened to my newest one, I was just like, yeah, Call What You Want 2 is not as good as I thought it was. just comparatively, but I'm always going to think my newest stuff's better. That's how it normally is. Because, I mean,
you've evolved.
Right. It's normally how it goes. But Call What You Want To has a lot of hallmarks of what I basically rap about even now. Yeah. Like, a lot of stuff, kernels of ideas are there. Well,
and your flow changed a little bit.
Yeah. I think I'm more did like me. Like, what would I do? Exactly. As opposed to, because I do a lot of, like, swagger jacking songs. Like, mm-hmm. we have one later I do a Lil Wayne song, but I'm basically trying to sound like Lil Wayne.
Yeah.
And there's that sort of rapping, and there's like, but what do I sound like, right? And so I think I just embraced that a little bit more. Also, I got Maurice on a track finally.
Maurice, man.
And Maurice, I met my very first few weeks in college. He asked me for $10. Dude can
sing and make a woman drop her pants.
He can. He's really good. But I met him on campus, and we hit it off, and he just asked me for $10, and I didn't even know this dude. And so to go from that to like, eventually, he's like singing on my stuff like years later, and yeah. He's really, really good. He tried to get a record deal, moved to Atlanta, just didn't work out or whatever. But I really like him on Call It What You Want To. Mm-hmm. Really helped a lot, I think. The fall, so just right after Call It What You Want To, I released That Dude.
Yep.
Now, it is super rushed, probably not completely finished. The mixing's not good. There are some good lines here and there. I got a little obsessed with trying to rap fast on certain songs.
Yeah.
But I was really just trying to get a mixtape done before I graduated because I didn't know what was going on after I graduated.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the whole point of that. So That Dude is not as good as Call It What You Want To, but there's still a couple. You have one song on your top five from that.
Yep.
So there's a couple good ones. And then from 2012 to 2016, I didn't do anything. I just didn't rap. I mean, every once in a while, like EJ or someone would hit me up to do a verse for them, and I would.
Mm-hmm.
Just every once in a while. It was very, very rare for me to rap. And then 2016, this producer here in town gave me a bunch of beats.
Mm-hmm.
I liked one beat on there and did that song. And then that kind of got me back into it. I was like, well, I'm going to mess around with stuff. And then I spent a year making my last mixtape, which I put out in May of 2017, of Resin Hits.
Yep.
And the whole idea behind that is like when you basically, like when you quit smoking weed, if you find it difficult, you're going to smoke the resin that's in the pipe, like the shit of the weed.
Shit of the weed, yeah.
But you're still going to do that. So, like, I'd quit rapping for so long, but I just couldn't quit rapping. So these were, like, the Resin Hits.
Yeah.
Was the idea behind the name. And I really enjoyed the name.
Agreed.
And I even made a song called Resin Hits, mm-hmm. which is super good. Now, I do think Resin Hits, top to bottom, is easily the best thing I made. I think the mixing's really good. I think I'm more honest to me, finally, like...
Agree. I mean,
there's very little projections. It's very much like, no, this is kind of how I feel. Just, I'm honest. Exactly.
Very honest. I was actually talking about this with my little brother, and his favorite song. I mean, as you know, he's a huge supporter of yours. I don't know how many tapes mixtapes he's listened to, but he was telling me that because we were listening to it in the garage, and Moe's a Goldfish. He goes, that is my favorite song. He goes, I listen to Resin Hits at least once a day because he drives around a lot.
Right.
And he goes, I listen to the whole mixtape. He goes, but Moe's a Goldfish is. I mean, he could tell you almost word for it. He's almost better than I actually he is probably right. on Resin Hits than I am. But I agree with him. I mean, there's some really good songs on there. But again, it's like you took that next stage of evolution and becoming more of yourself and becoming more of a, I don't give a fuck what anyone else has to say about it. I'm just going to rap about it, period.
Right. Well, and also like no one really listens in general. Like, I mean, I have like 100 listens on the mixtape on that piff. Like, so I'm like, well, I don't know. I say it on the mixtape. I made the mixtape for me because I wanted a new mixtape to listen to.
Right after that first song.
I mean, and that really is kind of how it is. And really the best part of all of it, and I think I'm somewhat creative. Like, I like creating things. I don't think I'm good, but I do like creating stuff. And I've made mixtapes that didn't exist, and me and you have listened to them hundreds of times.
Yeah.
And if I didn't make them, we wouldn't have listened to them.
Mm-hmm.
So in at least a little bit of way, I made something that just didn't exist before. So that's cool enough. And I get the lowest level. That's kind of where I feel about it.
Yeah.
Trying to think if there's any other important milestones. I have a little notes. I know Charles Hamilton was a big influence for me.
Yep.
Because he wasn't good. Like, I listened to everything he made, and his flow wasn't good, and his lyrics weren't good. He made his own beats. They were awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, well, if this dude can do it at this stage and he's not any good, I'll try.
Yeah.
And
I honestly, I think you could have been at least semi-known across the U.S. if you had pursued it.
Right.
I mean, you had multiple chances to do stage
Yeah.
And just do...
There was a few people that asked me here and there, but like, yeah, I just never had the confidence, and I already did too much on my own. Like, I already like wrote, recorded, mixed it.
Exactly. I mean, you did it, and then it was like from beginning to end.
I couldn't also be like, well, now I make the version that I would perform to, and then I'm going to promote it, and then I'm going to call a person to book stage time. And I just didn't have the confidence to feel like I was good enough. So I think I would have needed a little more. But yeah, I think after Call What You Want to, if I would have tried to be like, I could perform some of these, maybe something could have happened, but I just didn't. So It didn't.
For sure.
And really, I just think it's cool if someone came across my mixtape and listened to it. Like, same with our podcast now. Like, I think about our podcast basically the same way I thought about our music. Like,
yeah.
Anytime we get another listener, I'm like, that's fucking awesome. Like, I get really excited about it. Even if it's just one person.
Still, it's one person.
I'm like fucking pumped. So,
agreed.
All right. You have any questions before we get into our top five list?
No. I minimize this to 10 songs. I could have easily chosen probably 30.
Yeah, see, for me, going, because I went and listened to like every song, and because I am I'm somewhat embarrassed by some songs, because I did over talk. I talked about weed way too much. It is my crutch.
It is.
If I don't have a line, I'm like, well, I should come with a weed line. I can think of that.
But there are someone that were just, that killed it for me. And again, I look at it at the time that you did it.
Right.
Not comparatively to what you do now.
Right. So to me, I was like, well, which five verses would I be least embarrassed by? And those are the ones I seem to pick. But then again, like, my number one is my number one, and
yeah,
and all that. Also, like, I'd way talk about vaginas too much, but like, I remember early on, like, the only way I would get on collabs of other people's is for those. They'd be like, I got this slow jam for the ladies, I need you to rap about perverted stuff. Yeah. And like, that was just how I did
it. You did. Yep.
So that was kind of bread and butter, so I just kind of stuck with it. But all right, so Powwow, we will go ahead and start with your number five, and what would that be?
Number five is off Blonde Hair Don't Care, and that is Bad News.
All right, so that is 2010, and then we'll hear Mr. Barkley on this hook, and then it'll be my verse. I can kind of give a little bit of a heads up on it. Basically, the first two verses on the song of Moose and Barkley both are about women cheating on them, so that's what my verse is about as well. Crazy girlfriend, basically. I don't know technically if she ever cheated on me, but I'm like, probably did, so I just use that like... as that my emotion. Motivation yeah. and emotion to write it. And a lot of it's pretty honest. I think it's one of the first songs where I'm being like, let me get this off my chest sort of moment. Yeah. Even now, like, my two newest songs I have on SoundCloud are like super depressing, but like doing it like makes me feel better. Yeah. And that's kind of how this song was, right? Sure. So, all right, well, let's do it now.
Heard some bad news, girl, what the fuck did you do? I just heard some bad news, so girl, what the fuck, how could you? 20 years old, the worst news in the world. People saying, oh, I heard the homie smashed your girl. I started spazzing, acting like a volcano active. Everyone in my ass was a super slut, everyone captive. OMG, how could this happen to me? I tell her, get the fuck out, ain't gotta ask you to leave. Nice guys finished last, that's when I switched my roll up. Aaron became old, the biggest asshole that you know of. It's fuck this and fuck that. Don't give a fuck about your feelings, man, so why the fuck you gotta ask? Really, I feel bad for the girls who've inherited all my baggage, now I'm getting higher than a pyramid. I can't help it, never again will I trust a hoe. And if that's a problem, bitch, you can put back on your clothes. I ain't trying to waste time, man, I'm trying to get mine. I'm just tired of bad news all up in my headlines.
I just heard some bad news. What the hell you been up to?
Alright, so that was bad news.
Yeah, I mean, I know it was about cheating y'all, but I don't know what it was about that song. Like, it just... I could just relate to it, I guess. I mean, I did have a crazy that also cheated on me with that. And so it's exactly what you want to say if you could say that to anybody.
Right.
I mean, that's what got
it. Yeah, because spoiler alert, I didn't say that shit. No, like in real life, but exactly. Like in my head I did. Also think there was a lot to it of, like, I did turn into an asshole after. Like, there is some truth to that, like, because you knew me before and after that. Like,
yep.
I was a lot nicer of a person, and you're then after that, passive. I became more introverted and calloused, and so I kind of got that, and like, it is honest in
it
a way,
is.
And so to me, anytime I say something honest, I like it, where I'm like, oh shit, yeah, I guess I hit that one on the head, right? All right, my number five song is a new song. I chose it because I think it kind of explains a lot of probably what I want to say. Like, a lot of my rap songs say things that I wish I could just say normally, but it doesn't. Mm-hmm. It's easier just to rap it, right, or whatever. So this song's called Sell My Soul, and it's on Resin Hits.
Okay.
The part you're not going to hear at the beginning is there's... It's from the Batman animated series, but it's like screwed and chopped where it sounds like a demon laughing and talking and stuff. Yep. So I kind of use that for the whole Sell My Soul aspect of it. But we'll play it now.
I've always been fascinated by rap music. So I thought, geez, what if...
What if I did it? What if I spit it? Do I be different? Still don't know if y'all get it. Never felt gifted. I guess I'm too pessimistic. The type of rapper spit a shitty verse. Dude, and admit it. You know I'm honest. I got a bong and I'm on it. No skinny jeans. I got an ounce in my pocket. Tell me more stop it. They say I need to chill. But I tell my soul the devil for a deal if that dude was real. So offensive, off my hinges. Marijuana stenches while I'm eating minges. Get turned like Grinches. I'm raping the seed like I don't know what consent is. Fucking with me, then you a fucking idiot. I end this shit immediate. Leave you looking hideous, my girl the prettiest. My life an odyssey, I'm feeling like Odysseus. Potting me, got me walking wobbly, bro. I come here and take a hit of this. No little sister, brother, only child, nobody like me. Wanna talk shit, you can freestyle and write me. Take a lot of hits and I don't take them lightly. Asking if I'm really this high, bitch, I might be. So exciting, I've been rapping for years, but don't remind me. Say, Mo, stop it, with this rap shit, you need to chill. But I told my soul the devil for a deal if that dude was real.
I just really like that song.
I mean, it's good. I mean, I agree that that first part, it actually, whenever I do it, I make that demon, like I'm the demon.
Right.
But it just, the way that flow goes is sick.
Right. I mean, I think I'm pretty on point there. Honestly, my favorite part about it is I was watching the South Park episode where Oprah's Minge.
I was like, Minge, Gary, yes.
And that's where, why I wrote Minge in that. And I just really like the fact I used the word Minge.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I like that line. I think there was another one in there that I've already forgot. But, yeah, I like Resin Hits a lot. And so I just want to make sure I at least had two off Resin Hits. So I put that as my number five.
For sure.
There were definitely other things. Almost made it. That is what I went with.
Gotcha. No, my number four, hold on. My number four that I had was Second Chance.
Okay.
Off, call it what you want to.
Okay, so Second Chance. Now, honestly, I should have clipped EJ's verse for this because his is better, but I didn't think about it at the time. And this is the shortest of the snippets we have because it's only like half of my first verse. Mm-hmm. So here it is.
I grew up in low-income houses with old ladies playing skip-o. Once premature with a heart condition, I've always been sick, bro. Bending my mind, but this time I'm sucking limbo. I try to climb above the pain like a window. I stay on my tiptoes, don't want to serve the peace. And I'm sorry to the old homies, ain't heard a word from me. Don't take it personally, man, my life was fucked up. And when I finally found me, I seen we lost touch. I guess more than my age has changed in the last year. Starting to think being an asshole's what got me here. Nowadays, a few hundred less friends than Facebook says. But then again, shit, I'm happy that my ass ain't dead.
Yeah, so I like the song. Cut off a little short.
Yeah.
Because it gets too deep.
A little deep. But I mean, that's, to me, that's what I liked about it. It was very real.
Well, I love the whole 2 months premature, I've always been sick, bro.
Like that, I love that line. It's so clean. And
I like the, when I see I found me, I see we lost touch. Mm-hmm. I think that was really well written. I mean, not to like the brag or, but like I really liked the way I wrote that.
It was, and I mean that beat was awesome. But I mean that's,
yeah,
and then that's why I like that as my
EJ's part's awesome as well. Like EJAY is how he spells it. Bald headed yep. Bastard. If you ever want to look him up, every song he does of mine, he's awesome. You can tell when you inspire him. So like that song, I feel like my verse inspired him because he kept it very much on point, kind of the way mine was.
And isn't EJ the former Marine or?
He was in some military. I know the first time he recorded with me, he like recorded in a tent in Afghanistan.
Yeah, I was
like,
I know
he had a mic set up crazy, there, like awesome. Sort of thing. But yeah, EJ's super cool. Probably should have put his verse, but my bad.
For sure.
All right, my number four is off of Blonde Hair Don't Care.
Okay.
So this song is called Fuck the World. Now, I'm going to be honest here, and I don't tell a lot of people this. I hate the first like couple lines I do because I fuck it up.
Okay.
It starts off where I say, two middle fingers up, rap game Steve Austin, give me a fuck yeah if this weed keeps you coughing. And at the time, I was like, well, because it's weed, not beer, I'm going to say fuck instead of hell. But I've regretted it ever since. I should have said, give me a hell yeah, because that's what Stone Cold Steve Austin says.
He does. Now,
and I've regretted it forever.
Now, he does have plenty of shirts that have fuck yeah.
Does he?
Yes.
Okay, well, then I feel a little better.
The reason I know that is the amount of memes that I have seen with, I can't remember the player's name for the Saints, number 41, who missed that tackle last week. Mm-hmm. And he's doing a Stone Cold Stunner on it.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
And it has fuck yeah across his chest.
Gotcha. All right, but here is Fucked World. Again, Barkley is a little bit on this hook. You'll hear a little bit of him. He's just really good at hooks. That was definitely his strength.
I for sure. Like. This life has got me in a chokehold. I don't know what to let go.
Two middle fingers up, rap game Steve Austin. Give me a fuck yeah if this weed keeps you coughing. Always talking, keeping girls wetter than dolphins. Or how I'm spitting lines like dudes at the auction. But nobody sees my thoughts when I feel so sad in my head just bawling. I hold it all in like Ziploc sealed. And I don't know about y'all, but I know how I feel. It's fuck the world until this is over. Find it much easier, dude, when I am not sober. Should I end it all? She say no mosher. The world would get colder if I wasn't there to hold her. I see the whole world is selfish acts. My life got me choked up like Darth Vader attacks. The world fucked up to the max. Forever like a cat, get up on my spaceship and never come back.
All right, so couple things with that. It is like the prequel to a lot of my favorite songs. My number 1 and 3 song, this was clearly like a prequel-ish song to it. Like, yeah. It was a little bit more getting in my emotions. Like, I normally rap about this, but this is how I truly feel. Sort of like my whole thing there.
Yeah.
And I mentioned suicide in there. Totally becomes a huge topic for me in the future. It's just something I really like rapping yeah. about for whatever reason. And then specifically that line, I remember a lot because when I went to go write it, I was like, Powell, give me a phrase. And you were like, Ziploc sealed. Like, you gave me this big stumper of a word. And I was like, I'm going to write that in this verse. And then I did.
I remember it. It was good. And I need to correct myself. It's not fuck yeah. It's fuck fear, drink beer. That's what he says.
Oh, okay.
So it was a little different. But, I mean, I think if you would have said hell yeah, either way, I think it works really well. But agreed. I mean, I remember that was a... I thought you were, because I mean, there was plenty of times you're like, "Hey, throw me this," and I thought I could stump you.
Right.
Like, that was my goal, was trying to make it very difficult. It's like, nope. Like whenever Dylan said, "Choose a magic word like napkin," and try to make that cool.
Yep, remember that very well.
So, moving on. My number 3 is off. Call It What You Want, which is My Chick Bad, and there is one line in here that I'll wait till after this that I still remember to this day that I say quite often to you, which is just funny.
Okay. Yeah, and I will say on this song, this was like the song when they played it on SDB, when I did this verse, like all of a sudden everyone was like, I want you on my mixtape. So like this was the verse that kind of made me SDB famous or whatever, right? Like that was the one where we were like, nah, yeah, you're actually kind of good.
Mm-hmm.
Because I very much swagger jacked the song very well. So for here sure. it is. My chick bad, my chick hood. My chick do stuff that your chick wish she could. My chick bad, better than dirt. My chick bad, better than dirt. My chick bad. Hope this doesn't get taken down.
Yeah.
Your chick bad, dude, my chick worse. About to kill this first man, loaded in the hearse. Put my hands up, they skirts and tickle it till it squirts. She say she done it 100 times, but that feeling was the first. Give me 1 second, then I give her my portions. Chick so bad, man, she down with abortions. Not to beat a dead horse, but see that ass in them jeans. Keep my head, boy, knocking, man, hear them hoes scream. My chick bad. Probably problems with her father, but I be getting them wetter than shark seals and otters. My chick so bad, man, we playing cops and robbers. And your chick ain't bad, doo-doo-doo, so don't even bother. My chick hood, my
chick do stuff that your chick wish you could. So, I mean, I'm just, first off, dance. No one can see, but I'm just dancing right here with this song. But it's the line of probably problems with her father.
I really enjoy
the way you enunciate it. Just, I don't know what it is.
There's a lot of vulnerability in my voice, the way I say probably.
Mm-hmm.
And there is some about that, like, especially if you're listening on headphones, which I'm assuming people will listen to this on headphones. It just sounds really fucking cool.
Yeah.
I'm like, probably. I don't know.
It was cool. It killed it. But that song, you did Swagger Jacket, in my opinion, very well.
Right. Like I said, it just, everyone liked it. So that made me like it more.
Yeah.
When other people were like, that one's really cool.
Exactly.
I was like, sweet. All right. So my number three was my number one forever.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it just always was my number one favorite song I did. It's called I've Been Dead on Call What You Want To. I done the second verse, not the first verse. Even though I do like the first verse more, for whatever reason, when I was listening to it the other day, I just was like, I'm going to do the second verse. I don't know why I did that, but I thought it would be better for this occasion.
Yeah.
But this song is definitely like the prequel to Resin Hits. Like, it very much has that feel that pretty much the whole Resin Hits mixtape seems to have.
For my heart to feel alive,
the world's so empty on superficial bullshit. Everybody bust your balls like motherfucking pool sticks. I'm saying this, and I was one of the cool kids. So I feel bad for some of the shit y'all fools get. I need a toolkit to build a time machine. Go back to when I first rapped, when I was 19. Tell me it's not easy, mo, cause everybody hates. But really, they just jealous cause you everything they ain't. The ladies love the confidence, but don't get too cocky. Keep following your dreams, and don't let no bitch stop me. See, my mind's foggy, need more hours, drink some coffee. Some of y'all don't get the message, like my reception's spotty. So beat me up, Scotty, take me out the surge. I came too early with a 2 month premature birth. I know it sounds bad, but I'm ready for when it's over. When it's the great rhymes of the late era, my
and scared.
I don't know, I just like the way I say my full name.
Yeah.
Right? I think the full name really adds a good kick in there.
It does.
So anyway, that was like my favorite song forever. Now it's not even, I have another one from that same mixtape that's higher, but
I mean,
I still
that song
like
was
that song.
It was really good. Agreed.
Well, and it has that dude singing on the hook. It's totally not me.
Yep.
And he's all good, right? And I didn't have to make a hook.
Exactly.
That
so
was
I mean,
always easy. So yeah, always liked that song a lot.
You know what? That hook almost reminds me of that Gorillaz song. Like just the way that he, that flow and that singing that he has.
All right, pal. What do you have for your number two?
So my number two is off that dude. And in my opinion, I know I said My Chick Bad was great at Swagger Jacking, but this one, to me, killed it at 6 foot, 7 foot.
I agree. Now, I remember a lot about this song. One, I mean, I love Lil Wayne. And this is the best like thing I did on a Lil Wayne beat, so that was cool. Also, when I did this and people like share on their Facebooks, people were like, is that Lil Wayne? Now, I think that's stupid because I think I clearly don't sound like Lil Wayne.
I don't think
but
you do.
People, I did see other comments that said that. So,
I mean,
like,
when me and Jill listen to a song on the radio, and I cannot remember it now, but there is a dude, I've asked you about it before. I go, this dude sounds almost identical.
I think it was Watsky, but I could.
Maybe that was, and it sounded not only like you, but your flow and the way it just the way it was delivered.
Right.
But no, I think you have a completely different style, but to me,
yeah,
amazing
and,
song.
And both of our number twos, I just did the whole song because they're, I don't know how to explain. Like, they're just all together. There's no hook. It's just a straight verse for a whole song. So that's where I put it there. So, and I will say the thing I hate about 6 foot, 7 foot that I did going back listening to it is, again, my mixing is really bad. So, like, the way I used to mix stuff, and that's why everything before Resin Hits is bad to me, is, like, I made the beat as loud as possible, and then I try to get my vocals up to it as opposed to, like, wherever my vocals are, let's drop the beat down, mix it, and then raise it all. I just didn't think like that at the time.
Yeah.
And so a lot of things, like, my voice kind of seems blown out. And I remember, and so I try to mess with a lot, all of these before we started, but it's still a little, like, I'm too loud, if that makes sense or whatever.
For
but
sure.
You're next.
Bitch, I lost my ladder. Dropped
up my water. You 6'7", bitch, I'm taller. Don't catch a flow, get this bitch on the collar. You take me to the Maury show with bitch, I'm not the father. Stay behind my lines, MVP in the pocket. See the shock in your eyes like you're plugging to a socket. Man, I'ma do me, and I can't stop it. And I don't rap about money, but that can change when I got it. I do it for smoke a homer, any affiliates. I'm not cancer, agent, a cone, and the kids really sick. Fuck who you heard, I'm the one you're hearing. For the nerves, I smoke that herb, maybe swerve while I'm steering. If your bitch wanna play, tell her put a quarter in. Yeah, I've always done it big, never even suited in. And y'all say y'all is the best man, go recruit it in. I be on trees like Christmas ornaments.
Yeah, it was good.
I mean,
it's a lot of fun, like... It's different than the other songs because, like, it's a lot of punchlines, and it's not me being me. It's like, how can I make all this rhyme and be fun together?
Like, I'm sick, cancer, AIDS, and a coma.
Right.
I mean, it just...
And also, if I could go back, I would take out every breath you hear me take because I now know to do that. And at that time, I was just like...
And you just did it, yeah. But, I mean, in that first part where it's flowing, going... I mean, there was, like, 7 or 8 right in a row where you just nailed. And to me, that was really good, but... Honestly, I've listened to more of that 6'7" than I have with Corey Guns and Lil Wayne 6'7".
Yeah, I mean,
far.
I have nothing on Corey Guns. I'll say that. Corey Guns is dope. But
he is
I do like my version of that song for sure.
Agreed.
All right. My number two is a very same way. It's what I call Free Flowing is the name of it.
Mm-hmm.
On Call What You Want To. On Smokelahoma, I have 3 free flow 1, 2, and 3 songs.
Yep.
And basically what I mean by free flows, because they're not freestyles necessarily. It's more of like I have 3 pieces of paper from collabs or songs that I decided not to do. And then I just kind of put them together in my hand. And then I start a beat. And then I just go through the pages until I complete the beat.
Yeah.
And that was basically what I did. Now, the reason Free Flowing has been put over I've Been Dead is because at least once a week in my head, I will do the Free Flowing whole verse in my head because the beat is so catchy to me that it gets stuck in my head and I haven't even listened to it. So here it is.
So, okay, look. I'm the type to grab a mic after I'm bong hitting. I got a few songs written that can get your whole song dripping. Getting high, my mission, marijuana's what I'm getting. Fucking me, you get grilled like I'm tongue gripping. Oh my, I'm so high, my eyes are non-vision. This is all lines, no hooks, like a bad day gone fishing. The cleanest in the game, that's my humble opinion. And I know I could give a propane like Strickland. King of the hill, yes, I'm king of the kill. Should I take another hit? Yes, sir, I sure will. Then I take 4 pills, knocked out for 4 meals. Wake up, I'm 4 wheels, confused about the ordeal. Then I order more meals with some assorted bills. Barely afford any deals, but I blow it all for the thrill. Man, that's how I feel. Yes, yes, that's how I'm feeling. Man, I'm higher than a cell, I mean higher than the ceiling. Bitch, I'm in the building, waiting for destruction. Roll up that killing rotation, start buffing. Haters ain't nothing, I barely pay attention. I'm probably with my cousin, just hanging like suspension. Not hanging with no bitches, I'm hanging with my bitch though. Philosophical neck, damn, she got a deep throat. Make you think about it, you gotta check your ego. Man, I get thrown like a ball from Uncle Rico. Napoleon Dynamite, no, I ain't trying to fight. I'm just trying to stay lit like a pilot light. Get out my line of sight before you get shooted. Think the game's custom made, cause how well I'm suited. Couple Xanax in my Sprite, I call that shit my magic fluid. Watermelon Jolly Ranchers in it, cause I'm used to it. It's light pink, it make me think I'm about to act stupid. See if any ladies wanna cut, yeah, we get wounded. I'm higher than the moon is, brighter than the sun. If your chick knows what brute is, it's back to where she come. I mean, back to where she came, I'm back to run the game. My chick keeps saying, oh God, I think I'm about to change my name. Think I'm about to take my brain to a science laboratory. They probably say it's not the same, I'm in another category. Same stone like a quarry, same old story. In case you didn't know, I'm fucked up like an elevator orgy.
I just love that beat. The beat's so dope, man.
It is, man. I mean, there's so many. That esophagus line is just...
The deep throat.
Yeah, it's so good. I mean, there's so many just... It almost makes you think for a second on some of those lines. It just... It's funny.
Well, and really, that song was kind of inspired by the Ludacris song, Hip Hop Quotables,
because
it has a beat similar to that. Not exactly, but it reminds me of it, I guess, in a way. And he's like... Hi, I'm Ludacris. I'm high as giraffe pussy. And like, he does all right. Like, and so that was kind of what I was channeling when I was doing that song at the time. But like right now, if like, let's say me and you were somewhere and we're like I would never be in a club. We'll say we're in a club and someone's like, freestyle ballad. That's the verse I'm doing.
You grab that one and take
it. Because I know I can do it.
Yeah.
And I won't forget it because I do it, like I said, once a week. Where other things is like, might be so dependent on the hook to make sense, where this is just straight whatever. Like this one and then the Homa off.
Yeah.
Smoke Homa. I think I could probably pull off in a tight spot like that. So those are my freestyle weapons that aren't going to be freestyle.
For sure.
All right. So your number one, I do know what it is.
Yep.
Is interesting because it is not going to be me that we hear. We are going to, it's going to be J. King.
Yep.
Who, because J. King's verse was just so much better than my verse on the song that I'd rather listen to his.
There is one line that I still, me and Jill say every once in a while. It says, we're green and pink together like the Power Rangers.
Right. I mean, I like that one at the time. I remember like, haha, got that.
Exactly.
But yeah, so basically, like I mentioned before, I made a lot of weed songs and a lot of vagina songs. So made a song together called Marijuana and Vaginas.
Other way. Vagina and Marijuana.
Vaginas and Marijuana. And I asked J. King, because I did one verse that, in my opinion, isn't very good. And I asked J. King to do a verse, and he killed it. And then me and him split the last verse, where we go half and half. I will say after this, I think I caught up to J. King, but at this time, he just was better than me.
And he just got that.
He had been doing it longer.
He's got that voice, too. That's
right.
Just,
he has a cool voice.
Just go for it.
But anyway, I really like his verse in this song. So here it is.
Let me tell you what I think. I'm all about color, smoking green, hitting paint. Yeah. I smoke up on the dang nigga, roll another blunt. Tell the shawty, hit it up, rip it up, I don't front. But when she pass it back, I'm gonna hit it from the front. I ain't talking about a shawty, but I got a killer pump. And I'ma rock that body every time I let it off. Baby, I'ma set it off, I already got you on. Give a hit, take a hit, pop that pussy like Patron. Smoking doobies to the dome, my baby girl giving me gold. Heard you rolling on chrome when I'm rolling hydro, and I got my eyes low with a big booty hole. Make that hoe touch the toes, hit it smoother than my flows. Get that ushy gushy pussy while we smoking on that cushy, getting higher than a G4. Smoking on that C4, the bomb is hydroponic. I see weed like a sea floor.
Vagina, marijuana, vagina, marijuana.
So yeah, the seaweed like a seafloor is the dopest line I've ever had on
this. Just that little almost standard that ushy gushy pussy smoking on the cushy.
Right.
I mean, it's just he does have a very good flow.
Right.
But I don't know how many
times. I will say I did all those ad libs, so I'm technically on there in right? the background.
I just remember. I mean, call it what you want. I bumped all these mixtapes. I don't know how many times.
Right.
But that song alone, I remember I drive through my car and I just. Rewind. Go back to the beginning. Just keep going and playing it.
Yeah. I mean, there definitely were just songs that were always, you always went back to.
Exactly.
I mean, and J. King, I think he's the only person that's been on every one of my mixtapes since Call What You Want One. Could be wrong. You might have missed one, but he's the only one on Resin Hits, the only collab I have, because he's the only person that got back to me. Everyone else was like, yeah, I might do it. And I get it. I didn't rap for 6 years.
Yeah.
So everyone I knew. Most of them aren't rapping. I get it, because I wasn't either.
Mm-hmm.
But he still was, and so he is on Resin Hits. So he has to, like I said, him and Barkley are just right there as like two people I've never met, but I feel like I've met them because we're real cool. All right, my number one song is off of Resin Hits called Two Different People.
Yep.
Probably not like my best song ever, but it is what I've like. It's basically what I was always trying to say. Right, like there was always like one thing I've been always trying to say in rap music of like this whole I do feel like I'm two different people. Like there is me inside and just in general, like not even to do with rap. Like there's the me person and how I really like, you know me.
Yep.
Like I'm actually fairly funny and a nice person, but like when people don't know me, I seem very mean.
Mm-hmm.
Right, so like everyone has a mask and then the person they really are. Yep. Maybe not everyone, but I totally do. So this song was like trying to portray that, and then. Going further, even into rap music, like my early rap stuff is me pretending to be a rapper.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, what do rappers say about this? Oh, beat the pussy up. I'm going to rap about beating pussy up. Like, that was just how it was. So this was just really me being like trying to explain that, if that makes sense. I don't know if I succeeded, but I really liked the song. And I rhymed the word deeper with people, and it sounds totally legitimate. Like, you can't tell. So I always like that aspect.
feel like I'm Aaron, I feel like I'm Mo, I feel like I'm two different people. I feel like not caring, I feel like I might go down a hole even deeper. Depression, the question, well, fuck it, who asked it? Fast the mask, then puff, puff, pass it, till I swear I feel fantastic. Fake it till I make it, wait, I can sedate it. Did I create it? Why can't I escape it? It's strange, I don't hate it. I guess I deserve it. The topic is skirted and reworded and cursed. I'm alerted and nervous. I don't know the purpose. I get all these urges. I stop and get lost in my verse. Try to stop giving fucks like born again virgins. Start loading the beats in the back of the hearse. And someday I feel a winner. Someday I feel worthless. Write down my feelings, but I can't read my cursive. Get so nervous, wait, my brain things. Flash back to the school, y'all with chain links. I was a fat kid, so I hate that shit. But honestly, college was the same thing until I smoked on drugs, lost a little weight. Not sure it was a mistake, but things got strange. Since I was young, though, I heard this voice. Find my confidence and try to destroy it. Feel like I got no choice. I'm mentally captive, readily passive. Someday imagine my casket. Yeah, that's a real attention getter. Screaming at myself, cause I know it gets better. On the bright side, with the love of my life. And I'm lucky enough, she gon' be my wife. Like 10 years ago, dude, I couldn't imagine. And she's the fucking best, dude, how this happened. Kinda sad when my anxiety gets trapped in. Ego gets flattened, and I can't move. Stay in my room, need a ring for my mood, dude. I'm so confused, I don't know what to do, cause feel like I'm Aaron, I feel like I'm Mo. I feel like I'm two different people.
So anyway, really, I mean,
that was good, yeah.
I really like it. I mean, it just really touched on a lot of stuff. Like, I think being a fat kid is a thing that, like, fat kids understand. Like, if someone else who was fat growing up heard that part of, like, fat kid with the chain links and blah, blah, like, I just think they would get it.
Yeah.
They really would. I don't know. There's a lot to the song that I really, really
agree. I mean, like, I do think Resin Hits is really good, and Two Different People is a great song. I mean, like I mentioned earlier, my favorite song off Resin Hits is Moe's Goldfish.
It's fun.
I like that. I mean, but
it was a stretch for it to make sense, but I made it work.
It is. It is, but I mean, it does work very well for it.
Right. So I don't know if we're gonna, how much further we're going to go after this, but whenever this ends, I'm going to put another song off Resin Hits called, I think it's called Already. Yeah, that is what it's called. And it's kind of like a sequel to Two Different People. Like, it kind of follows up on that whole thought. So anyway, that'll be at the end of this episode. Now, I did have some that were really close, like Ramblings, also off Resin Hits, almost made it because it is very much like the Free Flow or 6 Foot, 7 Foot. It's that for Resin Hits where it's just like three throwaway verses that I put together and made a song out of. It has the best written line I think I've ever wrote. So if you're familiar with rap music at all, then you know there is a history of you refer to marijuana as Mary Jane, and it's a female, and then you're like, treat that like a human. So like SPM, one of my favorite rappers, he has this whole thing, he's like, I let my homies come over and we run a train. Like, it's really funny, right? Because you pass the weed. So there's always these lines, right, that reference that. And so I say something of, me and Mary Jane were very acquainted, but our Facebook status says it's complicated because I love her so much, but she's always leaving, always running out on me, and I know I'm the reason. And I just say it in a really
like that
cool
just,
way.
It just, but that, it makes so much sense, and it just kills it.
Right, because, you know, if you have ever smoked weed and possessed it, whenever you are running low, you say you're running out.
Yeah.
That is the terminology you use. And then it'd be like, they're leaving and I know I'm the reason. It's like a real relationship.
It
sort of thing. It's so good.
it is so good.
Like, that one line is so good to me that I almost put that on here, but I didn't. But anyway, that one got really close. And then My Style off Call It What You Want
is one of the
first songs that, like, I made it and I loved it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I just recorded, loved, and I was like, amazing, love that shit. Doug Funny, a lot of people like.
Doug Funny,
loved it because it was me. I was just making a dumb song.
Yeah.
The hook is just four words or whatever, and that's always, I hate those songs, but I make them. Because the way I really think of it is, like, I made songs for me and I made songs for you.
Yep. That's it, yeah.
And it was like, the ones that are about real shit, those are for me.
Yep.
And the ones that have dancey beats are for Powwow, who likes to dance. And
yeah,
that was just the way I did it. Nothing against it.
Yeah,
just the
I mean,
way I did
like
it.
I've got one on Inebriated.
Yeah, Inebriated was definitely like that.
And then one kicking it from On Summer Job of Land of the Dopeness.
I think it was Captain Mogier.
Is that Captain Mogier?
I believe so.
I can't remember. I remember
Bubble is my favorite off of Summer Job.
That one's
funny.
The bongos, bubble.
Yeah.
But no, that Land of the Dopeness, because it's the very first song that comes on. And I remember when I moved back home in 2009, I'd be going to play softball games in the summer, and my buddies who would ride with me would hear that song however long it took to get from their house to the softball fields, because I only played that song. That's how much I liked Land of the Dopeness.
Right.
I
will say one thing kind of just came to me. I've never had anyone... And I don't know if this is good or bad. like, I've never met someone and been like, oh, I rap. And then they hear it and they're like, I thought you would be better.
Agree.
They're always like, oh, shit, that's really you. So yep. That really means like I look like I should not be good at all. And I'm just adequate. Or like I'm actually good. I don't know which one it is, right? But that is kind of the way it goes. There's a song called Until It Kills Me on Smokelhoma, which I always really liked.
Yep. Her mascara, I really like.
Yeah, so one thing we did keep it all to my mixtapes. If this turns out to be a thing where people write in like, the fucking rap episode was the best. We want more of that. I mean, we can go 6 through 10.
Yeah.
I'll just my mix that we wanted. But also, I've done a lot of collabs. And I did pull up a lot of collabs when I was listening to all this. And there was a lot I wanted to put. But I was like, no, let's just keep it to like my mixtapes. But yeah, her mascara, I think, was a fun one. Because it was like this guy was like, I got this emo ex-girlfriend. And he basically explained the situation.
Mm-hmm.
And then I just had to imagine this girl. And then I wrote a verse about someone I've never met.
Yeah, I mean, it was...
And it turned out really good.
It was really good. But yeah, Really is another one that I like.
Yeah, I had that list as well.
And then, of course, the song Smokelhoma.
Song Smokelhoma, it's a fun song. It's not good, it's fun.
That's why I put it down. It's definitely a fun song for
sure. Intro for Call It What You Want To is so awesome. I was gonna say,
it is one of the better intros
it's like
I've ever heard.
Because I always have ideas for skits, because old rap albums all had skits, and they were hilarious. And I've never done them. I always think of them. But the intro for Call What You Want To is the closest thing I've ever done to like a skit.
Mm-hmm.
And it's really funny, I think. And then when I tell people, oh, yeah, I'm both voices, they're like, what? You're both of them? And I think if they listen to this podcast, they'll know.
Yeah.
But at the time, I wasn't doing like normal voices. I don't know. Anyway.
Yeah, agree.
Four words. Cool. What's the other one? I'm a talk shit.
Oh, yeah.
Is the one I was thinking of. Because I make this noise where I go, pew!
Yep.
And for whatever reason, at the end of this rap song, I make a weird noise like that. And I'm like, that was awesome.
Because it was like, it's something about a car, pew!
Yeah, I go, pew!
And it was good. I mean, we could go through almost all of your mixtapes. I could probably get easily a top five. Because I've listened to every mixtape, every song that you have done since I went to college in 2007. And then all of the videos that we don't have anymore that crash where for, I don't know, 4, 5, 6 hours, maybe 7 sometimes, where we just had videos of you just freestyling sitting on the couch.
Yeah. That reminds me of another. So one of my favorite rap stories is there's J-Mac, our friend J-Mac rap, and he has a cousin. Maybe they're, I don't know. Everyone's cousins,
I have no
rap.
Idea. They're, yeah.
But anyway, Wayne comes over with him and they bring over this old white guy, probably my age now. You know, I'm about to turn 30 in a couple days. To me, he's an old white guy because it was when I first moved into that apartment across the yard from where you eventually moved in.
Yep.
And I'm playing Sequoidon 3, I think it is, on PS2, maybe 4, whichever one it was with your pirates. And so I'm playing this RPG game. They come over and they're like, this is the dopest white rapper in Ada. You know, he's had the crown for a few years, so we brought him over to meet you. Like, I'm supposed to, like... Fuck, I don't even know, man. It was so dumb. I mean, honestly, it was dumb. But, like, I wanted to be respectful to everybody. And I was like, oh, nice to meet you, whatever. And then Wayne's like, y'all got a freestyle. And at the time, I was all about a freestyle. I'm like, that wasn't no problem for me. So I started freestyling while playing a game. Like, not paying attention at all. There's, like, barely a beat. And I'm playing an RPG game with pirate ships, just freestyling bullshit.
Yep.
And then this guy goes... And I'm like, oh, he's actually fairly good. And then he goes into a hook, and I'm like, oh, you wrote all this.
Yeah.
Because you don't rap four
lines
in a
row. You prepared this before you came over.
Right. And then he, like, just didn't like me because I didn't take it seriously enough, I guess, at the time. But I remember that was a real fun day. I was like, all right, random guy coming over here to test me or whatever. And that was always – people would always want to battle. And I was like that, too. I wanted to battle that one meth head rapper guy, and his promoter wouldn't let him.
Yeah.
And we ran him out of Legends. Like, he has to battle me.
Yeah, it's like, it was, oh man, there were so many times when we did it. Every party, every time we went out to the club or something.
I mean, and someone else we didn't talk about a lot, and it's LV. LV was a big deal with all this.
Yes.
I mean, he was always around. He loved my music more than me.
I remember the day we went, and maybe it was when we seen Sideshow.
Yeah, it was the day we saw LV at his halfway house. We picked him up, took him to Sideshow's house.
Yep. And we had the hype man, hype off. I don't know what
right,
you would
y'all
say.
Had to like sing all the songs to see who is the
and it
number
got
one hype man.
So crazy.
Yeah, he was so competitive. And like he had been in jail for a year, but he's like, I can do it better. And you're like, no, you can't. I was like, you've been in jail.
You've not listened to it. You don't know. And it just got nuts. But I mean, there was a lot of your rapping that centered around the fraternity when we were in college, of the people we hung around. Yeah. I mean, just consistently.
Well, and like I think it's Summer Job, maybe called Captain Mogier. But one of them, I do a song called Legendary, which I pulled the Barney Stinson Legendary, you know, sample. On and the whole goal of that Captain song Mojang. Was I was gonna make every line end with Eon, like the noise Eon, and I do it.
Yeah,
it's on the hard. And there are some songs that were just like that, like Stuntin' Hard, a Showtime mm-hmm. song. I was like, every line is gonna end with the word Asian.
Yeah,
and like that will be the noise. And so there was a lot of just challenging stuff, or writing a verse backwards was something I did a lot. Like, well, I want to end with this, mm-hmm. and so I would write the last line, the next one, and next one, all the way to the front. And it was just so much fun. Like, I've never been as passionate about anything as much as I was, like, for a couple years there of, like, no, we're recording. And it didn't even matter. Like, no one cared about it. It was, like, only we were listening to it.
Yeah.
But
it was still, like...
It was a lot of fun.
Exactly. It was super fun.
And we cared. And we had on the mixtapes. And so, I don't know. I don't regret it. But I think if I went back, I would do something. I think I would not put out some of the shitty shit. But at the time, I was like, fuck, I need 18 tracks. Just put it out because I'm getting better. But that probably wouldn't have mattered anyway. I probably would just maybe try to perform somewhere once.
Yeah.
See how that went.
I think that would have made a big difference. But yeah, I mean, agreed. I mean, I don't know how many people have listened to the actual song. I would say hundreds.
Well, it's not. So the thing is, like, Dat Piff, you know, I put him on there, right? Mm-hmm. And Call What You Want 2 has a few hundred just on its own. And then everything else has, like, a couple hundred or 100. But then other websites have it up, too. So, like, this other mixtape website put it up that I didn't upload it to. Mm-hmm. And it would claim it has, like, 1,000. But those could be fake. I don't know. And then there's another one called Number One Music, who emails me all the time. And I put up some songs on there. And, like, I did a Deep, the song Deep by Big Sean. I did one on that. Would have been on my top 5, but it's super offensive to people, so I didn't put it. But I do love it. It's it's, like, half freestyle, half written. I didn't freestyle it ever anymore, but that song I did. So I do really love that song. But I put that song up on that website, and it claims it has like 3,200 plays. I don't know if that's accurate.
Yeah,
because it's more of a European website, and I get messages all the time. People that are like, "I love your song," and they're all European weird spellings and shit. That could be correct. I don't know.
You're like, but I don't want to click on and get a virus or some shit.
Right. So I don't really mess with it. Normally I just respond thanks. Like someone's mentioned my call. Thank you so much. But yeah, I don't really know much. Maybe people who listen to our podcast might go and listen. I might see a spike there.
Yeah.
But at the moment, podcasting is filling that void because I don't really have enough time to write and record and everything. And I'm really weird. Like, I don't like recording in front of certain people. Like, it is weird for me to record with Koopies here.
Yeah.
Because I know I get loud and I sound dumb. Like, I will make weird voices when I record. That's part of the process.
Yeah.
But I do get somewhat embarrassed by it. But I may make one. The last two songs I made, are really sad. They're on SoundCloud. I mean, they're just depressing, I guess. But I was depressed when I made it, and I still am a little depressed. I think if I kept making songs right now, they would still stay in that, kind of in that vein. And I may do it and make it called like A to the Emo.
there you go.
So like do like the whole emo thing. But like I know I really like the two new songs because they're new. But like I could be listening to them and like almost cried listening to those. I was like, I know they're too like shouldn't be my reaction. But I was like, I wanted to make them when I made them. And there's still lines like getting stuck in my head now from that. And I'm like, oh, it's a pretty good line.
Yeah.
But anyway, we'll see if I ever make another mixtape. It's really hard for me to say I'll never will because I said that for years and then I made Resin Hits and it was really good. Like good enough, at least that I like it.
I think you could. And I mean, I think if I ever get the time, cause that's difficult with these two boys. But I don't know how many times where I just sat in the room while you'd be recording.
Right.
I mean, I was probably there for, I'd say, at least a good 70%, 75% of the songs recorded on all these mixtapes.
Yeah, for sure.
And just watching you go through it, I mean, like, you used to do it where you would only do it all in one take, like, 8-take Eddie was on right. one song. I mean, you had to go through it, and just looking at the progression, I think would be... I would like to see another mixtape.
Mumble rapping really helped out Resin Hits, in a way, like... So the song Resin Hits and Mo is a Goldfish and a couple others, like I have like a base thing written down, But like, I didn't hold true to like, well, I would normally do a flow like hit. I'm like, I'm just gonna fuck with it because no, rap music's bullshit now. Like,
I mean, there is a lot.
No one follows fucking real rapping.
Hey, Lil Yachty.
Right. So like, I would just get to where I'm like, well, I'm just gonna repeat a line 5 times and I'm gonna say it weird, and then we'll see what that sounds like. Or like the intro on Resin Heads, the Dopest Has Spoken. I think is the name of it. I say shut the fuck up because the Dopest has spoken, but I say it like in all these weird voices, and everyone that hears it is like, cool effects, and I'm like, actually, I'm making a weird voice.
Yep.
Like, there's no effect for that.
But it sounds like there's effects. It's really good.
So I'd had a lot of fun with it, as well as, like, it was pretty spot on to how I felt at the time or whatever. And I really just want to make it before I got married. So I don't know if it's, like, now that I'm married, I can't record or anything. I don't think I have to hold to that. But I don't really share.
That wasn't in any of the vows or anything.
But I don't really share it very much. My parents aren't fans. They never have been. Most people just aren't fans. Like, and even like great friends of ours will be like, oh, you rap, cool, I'll check it out, and they just don't.
Yeah,
whereas in like, we're like your brother-in-law, okay, I really like your, or he's not technically, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I know what you mean.
Your nephew's father.
Yeah.
And I really like him. We get along very well. I tell him yesterday at your son's birthday party, I said, hey man, we have a podcast, me and Powell, you should check it out. And he goes, well, I'm gonna make my own podcast. And I was like, that doesn't mean you can't listen to ours.
Yeah.
If you made one, I would listen to yours. Like, I don't get, and I guess people are, right? There are people like that. Like, if I make music, well, I make music.
Exactly.
I'll listen to yours if you listen to mine. Like, what's wrong with this? So, I don't know. It's hard to get people to listen to your shit. Not even talking on Resin Hits. Like, I'd post something on Facebook.
Yeah.
Like, listen to my song. It's 3 minutes long. And then after a day, it's like 5 people like it.
Exactly.
And 3 of them actually listen because I can see those
you
stats.
Can see the ones
and
listening.
You're like, I mean, I'm not saying I'm like the greatest friend or whatever, but 3 minutes ain't shit to listen to a song.
Listen to it, be done.
I made it. See if it's good. Anyway.
Agreed.
So those are some of the struggles. And there's just so many people make shit. And I get it. And you know how many white people I've met that told me they can rap and they're not.
They're terrible.
Any good. And so I get like Big Red.
I'll say Big Red.
Your homie Big Red.
Who is the most. I don't know how to say it because I'm not going to say it.
Well, he said the N-word like 9 times in 4 lines.
And it was just,
a little
it was
white
very
guy.
Uncomfortable.
Yeah.
Because I'm like, I've heard plenty of people say that's not black. But the way he was saying it's like, that was his only rap style.
Yeah.
And I'm like, bro, this is just.
I mean, I don't respect like famous rappers who have to end the line like that.
Yeah, agreed. And it is very annoying, but.
Weak.
It is. I don't know. I think if you put it up, I think there's a few people that would just guaranteed listen to it. Like that we know it in the immediate vicinity. One of them that I'll have to give shout out to is my little brother. He's listened to every mixtape that I've ever given
him. And all of his friends, like those were like my first fans I met.
Yeah, like they
I
were
coming up and seeing him, and then like kids were coming over
Dakota,
to meet me.
Yep.
Like, oh, I gotta meet you. I've listened to all your stuff, and I'm like, oh, that's awesome.
Agreed.
Man.
And I think that if, and my thing is, almost I don't know if actually one person has told me that they didn't like it, because I've showed it to most of my family in general. And it's just once they hear it, they're like, "That's awesome! Can I get a tape or can I get a you know or a CD?" And it's but it's like people don't want to take that time to listen to even one or two songs to determine if they like. It's like, oh, I like, you know, Cher or whatever.
Right. And I always found it funny that like Johnny, you're big, and all these people that love country music always liked me rapping.
Especially my big brother, who's easily, I love you, Johnny, but you're super big racist. just that's just how that is. But it is funny. That's for sure.
All right. Well, we went a little long, so I think we should call it good here. Do you know what our top five is next week?
I'll be honest, man. I have
yesterday,
no idea.
Last night, I just laid here and wrote about 15 new ones on there.
Did
so
you?
We got to keep the list going. If anyone has any topics, I would love for people to email us because that's always cool. Or rate us because if you get enough ratings on iTunes, it'll show up. Guess what? We don't have enough. Says you don't have enough.
So next week is top five favorite NFL players.
Okay.
So, and again, if anyone liked this episode or
you want
to hear
more about, pretty good one for Pro Bowl week and everything.
It is. It's
going to
be good. I mean,
unplanned.
Right. If anyone does like these songs or they want to hear about more of Mo's rap music, please email us. He'll be happy to send you a link or the entire mixtape, whatever you want. Again, email us at thepowwowwithmo@gmail.com. That is thepowwowwithmo@gmail.com.
All right, that's all I got.
That's it. And by the way, those polls in Philadelphia look like they're going to be getting worked on tonight. It's 31-7.
All right, man.
All right. Peace, guys.
Peace.
But sometimes they say get stuck in my brain, starts eating away, and then my life turns gray. Fuck my dreams, I guess I can't. No matter what I think, I got time to grow, but can't change the mistakes. Most days I feel like I should go so far away. Feel I need some distance, cause I feel so distant, can't blame no one else. My mind just twisted, but I don't mention, I just live right through it. It become therapy for me to make my music. Just do this mixtape to prove that I can do it. No delusions, I'll be famous, I ain't trying to feel stupid. I fucking love it, and some days I wish I didn't, cause I lack ambition, feel like I wasted passion. Shit happens, getting too heavy. Somebody light and passing. Take a moment, take a deep breath. Take a deep fat bolt straight to my chest. Convince myself this is me doing my best. But I digress, let my mind digest. Let my time be next, let my rhymes inflex. Let me write this text, get inside my head. Will I be happy when I quit or will I cry instead? And feel inside I'm dead. Find the real shit hard, I won't lie. That's why I make tracks about smoking pot and getting high. Paranoid, everyone always trying to judge me. Honestly, probably no one really give a fuck for me. No one give a buck for me, so I rap for free. Do it for me, I need a few minutes on your Facebook feed. But I know I don't get it, so I'm like, pass me that bong. Fuck y'all, you know I got to get it, come on. Self-deprecation, got many questions, don't have much patience. Some days I hate everyone like fuck your faces. I need these smoke sessions, get to calmer places. My oasis, my whole day is daydreaming about owning spaceships. I need to own a spaceship, no motivation. I'm on these PlayStations, how many hits have I taken? I lost count. If y'all started from the bottom, must be underground. Don't get me started, boy, I shut you down. Don't come talk crazy when I come around. I'm liable to snap like two fingers make sound. Might act like I'm going to fill you with rounds. But I ain't got no guns, bro, you can calm down. Sometimes I feel like I'm two different people. One good, one evil, and both, man, I need them. Just need some cohesion so we can see even. Don't let the disease any logic and reason, but it's not easy. Emotions start approaching like tides of an ocean. I'm stopping, I'm hoping, I'm staring, start quoting Mo. But I'm thinking like Aaron, that's what I know. But they stop caring, personal growth's not for sharing. I'm fucking weird, dude, that shit's apparent. Do I fucking care, man? Not at the moment. We lighting up, I'ma fucking blow it. Break it down, and then we roll it. Take a joke, hit, tell me you a fucking poet. It's like I'm good at rap, deep down, I fucking know it. Yeah.